ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. He in Christ the Lord. God of God, light of light eternal, though he abhors not the virgin's womb.
Well, a very warm welcome to our service here at St. John's Harborne. And a particular welcome if you're joining us for the first time. It's really good to have you with us. You might like to find out more and be in touch with us at hello@stjohnsharborne.org. Today we come to the end of our short Advent series, four-part harmony. And we've been looking at each of the four Gospels and how they present complementary views of Jesus, his person and his work. And today, Jon Tattersall, our Associate Vicar, is going to be looking from John's Gospel and Jesus as the revelation of God. And we look forward to hearing from John. Now, along with this, we're going to be worshipping God in song. We've got some all-age input. We're going to be hearing from Joe Jowett, one of our GPS mission partners. We'll have an opportunity for those of us who are regular members to give to the work of St. John's, and we'll be bringing our prayer requests to the Lord. And as this is the third Sunday in Advent, we're going to be lighting the third Advent candle as we look forward to the coming of the Saviour of the world. Our first was lit to remind us of the hope that we have in God. The second, for the peace that he brings us. And today, as we light this third candle, we are reminded of the great love that God has for us, revealed supremely in Jesus. John writes in his Gospel, God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Let's pray. God of love, your Son Jesus is your greatest gift to us. He is a sign of your self-giving love. Help us to walk in that love during this season of Advent as we wait and prepare for his coming. We pray this in the name of Jesus, the King of love, our Saviour. Amen.
Emmanuel, Emmanuel, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, come have your way. Welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight over on the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Christ, the newborn King, God. the sea. Lift up his name in all the earth. Lift up your voice and give him glory. For he is worthy to be praised. For he is worthy to be praised.
For you are worthy.
For you are worthy to be praised.
Thank you that we can sing, lift up your name. We thank you that you are God Emmanuel. Lord, you have come down to meet us. Lord, meet us where we're at. Lord, whatever we're going through, Lord, you want to be with us. You want your light to shine in us.
The Holy One is here. And come bow before Him now with reverence and fear. And in Him the sin is found. We
I wonder if, whether like us, you have started decorating your house ready for Christmas. I wonder if you've got a Christmas tree and filled it full of lights like we have. Or I wonder whether you've covered your house in lights. Or perhaps maybe you've been out and seen the lights on various houses. Maybe you've been for a drive to see if you could find the tackiest light display in your area. It's a real season of lights, isn't it? And we just love to enjoy the lights of Christmas. And we also recognise, though, that where there is light, there is also darkness. And so I wonder if when you come home and you come to a dark house, how that makes you feel. I know for me, coming home from work with a house in darkness is uneasy. But when you come home to a house that's filled with light, it's a place where you know is going to be safe and warm, and you know that there's a welcome there. A little bit later on, John is going to be helping us think about how Jesus is light, how Jesus is life, and how Jesus is the beginning. But for now, we're just going to think about this idea of Jesus as light. And Nancy and I have got an activity that you could do at home with little ones if you want to, or even if you don't have little ones. It is an activity for everybody to help you think about how Jesus is the light, and the light that gives us life. I was reading in John chapter 8, verse 12, where it says, where Jesus says, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And even though we know that there is darkness, we don't need to be afraid of it, because Jesus is our light.
Hello, everyone. And today we're going to make something you like, put on your like switch, and then you just need some pens and a ruler and like some piece of card or paper.
That's right, you need all those things. So, like Nancy said, we're making something to go around the light switch. And so we've got the card, and we've cut a square hole in it. So we measured our square to be 8.5 centimetres. So when we put it up to the light switch, that will fit right on there and go around it. And we're doing that because we're thinking about Jesus and how Jesus is light, and how Jesus brings light, so that whenever we put, whenever we need to put the light on, we can go over and we can see our light switch surround, saying that Jesus is light. Or how have you decorated yours, Nancy? What did you do?
I put a sunshine and I put God's star up in the sky, and I've written Jesus, and I've written light of the world.
Lovely. And on mine, I've found a quote from Charles Sturgeon, and it says, "He is light within, light around, light reflected from us, and light to be revealed in us." And so that's what my one looks like. So, do you want to show yours, Nancy? Come on, get a bit closer. You show it off. That's it. Lovely. And so we're going to go and put these on a light switch. And whenever we go into that room, we're going to think about Jesus. As we turn the light on, think about how he brings light to our lives. So should we do a quick prayer? Let's say, "Dear Father, dear Jesus, thank you that you are the light. Thank you that you bring light and that you give light. And we pray that we would always know your light in our lives. Amen.
Today's reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning. I wonder if you've ever had the experience of coming home from somewhere, switching on the TV and being dropped right in the middle of some urgent breaking news. And we see those words, breaking news, and we're suddenly starting to think, oh no, what has happened now? Now, we might search for clues on the screen. Perhaps there are some words scrolling along the bottom that tells us the gist of what is happening, or maybe there's an interview between experts and we try and pick up on key words or phrases. Or maybe you've had that experience where you walk into a room and everyone is in the middle of a film. Now, you might recognise some of the actors, you can kind of figure out the genre, but as to what is happening and why and what any of it means, well, you need to have either somebody very kind and very, very patient pause the film and explain it all to you, or better still, watch the film from the start. You see, where we begin and at what point we jump into a story matters. And when we come to the Gospels, where they begin matters. Each one of them is telling us something important about Jesus and who he is. Now, over the last 4 weeks, as we've travelled through our Advent series, we've been exploring the four Gospels and what each of them have to say about Jesus. Who he was, who he is, and why he matters. And so Matthew begins with a genealogy that connects Jesus to Abraham, which is important for his primarily Jewish audience. Mark, writing to a Roman audience, doesn't bother with any of that and gets straight into the action with John the Baptist. Luke, who's connecting with Gentile readers, locates things squarely in historical events, Roman emperors, high priests, and of course, a census. But John, who we think was probably writing later in that century, around 80 or 90 AD, possibly with copies of the other Gospels in front of him, written much earlier in that century, John takes us back way further than the first century in Judea, or even Abraham. He takes us back even before the beginning of time, into the mists of eternity. And he wants us to get the big picture, and in doing that, wants his readers of the Gospel to understand that unless you do that, unless you have that bigger picture, you'll never really understand what's going on in the story. It will always feel like a film you've walked in on, a partially told story. And right here in these first five verses of his Gospel, John tells us three important truths. Well, he tells us more than that, but three we're going to look at today about Jesus that helps us to shape the rest of the story. They help us to see the central character of that story, Jesus Christ, in clear view. And it helps us take our place in the story too. And so firstly, John wants to tell us that Jesus is our beginning. In chapter 1, verse 1, it says, of course, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, those words may be super familiar to us, so much so that we don't stop to think about them. So let's unpack them a little bit. In the beginning. Now, those words should ring a bell in our minds, especially if we've ever read the Old Testament, because the book of Genesis, the first book in the Hebrew Bible, begins with these words, In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, John is throwing us back to the events that started the creative process with the universe and the cosmos, and he's making a clear claim here, as he does throughout his gospel, a claim we have to understand if we're to understand anything about Jesus Christ. He is God. And what John is saying here is this: there was never a time when Jesus Christ was not. He was with God in the beginning. And through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. Now, the Greek word John uses in this passage for the word beginning is the word archa, and it means origin or source. It's where we get the word architect, for example. And one of the humbling things about reaching a certain age is keeping up to date with technology and how it works, at least in my experience. Now, recently, the software on my computer needed updating, and when it had updated, of course, a few things have been moved around and changed. And now, this really annoys me. I know, first world problems and all that, but it does really irritate. Now I have to learn to do the things I want to do all over again. And at one particular point last week, I got so angry that I shouted, "I just wish the person that designed this update could be right here, right now, so that I can ask them how it's all supposed to work." And I think this is something John wants us to get. We have access to the architect, the source, the origin of all things, the one who knows our original design, who knows how we're supposed to work. And he stands ready to help us find it again. Maybe our lives at the moment feel a little bit like that software on a computer, or if you like, an IKEA cabinet that we're desperately trying to build. Things are not as they should be. Things are out of place, confusing, perhaps even with badly installed internal program is how it feels. I love how John starts this gospel and locates the coming of Jesus into the mess and the dysfunction. The one who started it all, the source, the designer, the architect, is coming. He knows who we are and what we're made for. And when we're stuck and we don't know what to do, John is telling us we have access to the Maker. And because he is God, he comes to us in order to bring us into the life of God. Now, there is, of course, another Greek word famously used in this passage, logos, which we translate as word. Now, in Greek thinking, logos means not only the spoken word, if you like, but also the words that we think, rationality, if you like. And the Greek world at this time, logos was the divine shaping, ordering, and directing principle in the universe. But what's shocking for John's Greek readers is that in traditional Greek thinking, that the divine would have had nothing to do with the material world or the historical world. But John wants to say this: that logos is not an impersonal divine force. It is a person. He took on flesh and blood and he moved into the neighbourhood, as Eugene Peterson memorably put it. It's the moment where the one who began it all, who made us and knows each of us by name, makes himself reachable. That, John wants to say, is what the incarnation, the coming of God into the human race, into the human story, is all about. And I wonder if in this year of challenge, of difficulty and fear, we might need to hear the truth that John offers us. That no matter what our lives look like, what brokenness we face, and no matter what mess we've made of our lives, the one who made us, made everything, and the one in whom is found ultimate wisdom, and who can help reshape, reorder, and redirect our lives because he is the Logos, has made himself reachable once and for all in the person of Jesus Christ. And I love the fact that throughout John's Gospel, in fact, all of the Gospels, we meet person after person who gets a new beginning in Christ. He is the Lord of new beginnings, precisely because he is the beginning of all things. And I wonder where we might need to know that for ourselves today. I know I do. And the second truth that John wants to tell us is that Jesus is our life. In him was life, we read, and that life was the light of all humanity. Now, some of you might remember the film Braveheart, telling the story of William Wallace. And there are some films that stick with you for a very long time. And for me, Braveheart is one of those things, with visceral, graphic, incredibly realistic battle scenes and with a story set against the perceived and very real injustices inflicted upon the Scottish people by the English in the 13th century. It is not a film for, excuse the pun, the faint-hearted. It is a film with some truly memorable lines of dialogue, not least the cry of freedom right at the end of the story, and the stirring battle speeches throughout the film. But for me, there's one line above all that stands above all the others, one that is probably made 1,000 movie posters, and it's probably featured in 1,000 sermons like this. But it's where William Wallace says this: every man dies, but not every man truly lives. And I think John's got something similar to say about Jesus here. The word he uses for life is the Greek word zoe, from which we get the girl's name Zoe. Now, there is another word John could have used, and that word is bios. And that's the word that's used to make a simple statement about whether something is alive or dead. It's a generic word, if you like. But zoe means something else completely. It means a life with dynamic, life-giving energy. And John uses that word because it describes the life that Jesus has with his Father in eternity, and is exactly the new kind of life that Jesus speaks of throughout John's Gospel. And so Jesus talks about living water. He talks about the bread of life. He talks about his mission as coming to bring life, and life abundantly, as it says in John 10:10. He brings that kind of life anywhere he goes. And so we see water turned into wine, sickness to health, paralysis to movement, doubt and fear into faith and joy, a lack of bread into abundance, blindness into sight, death into life. And I wonder how many of us are right now settling for a bios life, when Jesus offers us his zoe life. C.S. Lewis put it like this: we are half-hearted creatures fooling around with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us, like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are too easily pleased. Are we caught up in things that make us far too easily pleased? Is there an area of our life that needs Jesus's dynamic life? I think we also need to be brave this coming year and ask this question, not just of ourselves, but of our church. In 2 Corinthians 13:5, Paul says to the church in Corinth, examine yourselves and see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. And I wonder if we need to ask ourselves as a church community and also as followers of Jesus, if Jesus's life is found in us. Is this a place where we attend, not just to helping people to exist, but also helping people to find that life that Jesus and only Jesus offers? Can we use this season that we find ourselves in to rest and to examine ourselves? To ask ourselves, are we helping people find that dynamic, powerful, magnetic life that can only come from Jesus? The life that we lost in the garden and is restored at the cross, where Jesus took on our sin, our shame, our mess, our death, our everything in order to bring us to his life, the abundant life in him. Do we know that life, John wants to ask us? Well, if you look to Jesus, you will find it, he wants to say. And lastly, John wants us to grasp the truth that Jesus is our light. In verse 4 again, in him was life, and that life was the light of all humanity. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Now, as many as you will know, we are most definitely in this house cat people. And there are many benefits to owning a cat. They can be the perfect company on a cold winter's night. They are reasonably clean animals, and they don't feel the need to eat everything left out in the kitchen and then regurgitate it back onto the floor. Yes, I'm looking at you dog owners. But there are, if I'm being honest, some negative things that we've discovered along the way. The countless mice that need to be rescued at 2 a.m. The fights with foxes, other cats, and what sounds like bears outside our house. The fact that they make a beeline for Auntie Betty when she comes to stay, despite the fact she can't stand cats. And of course, the hair. We have learnt the value of a decent lint roller in our pockets, in our bags, in every car, in every location in the house, as we discover just how covered in cat hairs we are, normally, once we've gone out the door. It gets everywhere. And I think John wants to say something similar about the light that Jesus brings. There is no corner of this world, there is no corner of your life that Jesus' light cannot touch or get to. That Greek word that John uses for light here is phos. But it means more than just mere physical light. It means also the illumination of the mind. And that's a major theme in John's gospel. There are some interesting contrasts between those who are said to be in darkness and those in light. And so we have the Pharisee Nicodemus, not quite ready to see who Jesus is in chapter 3, who meets him at night. In chapter 4, we've got the Samaritan woman at the well, about as far away from the Pharisee as you can get, meeting Jesus in the heat of the midday sun because she's able to come to a recognition of who Jesus is after a lot of conversation. We've got those who are physically blind being able to see, and those who are spiritually blind choosing to remain in that state of darkness. And of course, we've got John describing Judas on the night where he was betrayed as disappearing into the night to betray him. Jesus, John wants to say, comes to bring light, not just physical illumination, but also in the sense of our understanding of who he is and what he's come to do. And he can do that, of course, because he is the Logos. He is the ultimate wisdom. He is the pinnacle of human reason and human philosophy. And that light is breaking into this world and overturning the darkness gradually, but it is happening. And you and I can be displays of that light to the world. And I wonder, is there a part of our life that needs to know that kind of light right now? Are there areas that we're living in darkness? Maybe that's in terms of confusion or a lack of clarity about who Jesus is. And if that's you, then come and join the Alpha course that we're starting online on the 19th of January. And it's a safe place where you can ask questions and explore this person called Jesus. Or maybe it's in terms of a rejection of his reign in us. Are there areas where we are resisting his rule in our lives, where we're keeping him at arm's length? Are we struggling with doubt in our faith? Are we longing to ask questions we don't know the answers to? John makes it clear that there is a firm offer of light to all of us when we look to Jesus. And here is the thing, the more that you are in the light, the more you're aware of what is not light. The brighter the light, the darker the shadows, as it's been said before. And there is no place where that light is not prepared to go. That is the message of the incarnation, of God with us, of Christmas, of Easter. As Psalm 139 puts it, even the darkness is light to you. As the psalmist goes on to say, even my darkness is light to you. We come with brokenness. We come in loneliness, in depression, with anxiety. We come with broken relationships, marriages. We come with doubts and fears about whether we are even going to survive this coming year, financially, emotionally, maybe even literally. But John tells us this: there is no darkness that God's light cannot overcome. There is no hole that we can climb into that Jesus's light cannot reach. And there is no place we can hide in guilt or shame where this light cannot touch, reach, and transform, because he loves us and longs to bring his light into our darkness. Jesus stepped down into the darkness to show the way, to light the way. And I wonder, as part of this, if we can think in this Advent season of ways in which we can do something that brings light to others. Check out our Christmas giving opportunities on our website to make a real difference to people in all types of poverty and need right now. Call on your neighbour. Ring that person. Let's examine ourselves afresh today and make sure his light shines in and through our lives. So these are the things that John longs for people to know about Jesus Christ as they read his gospel. Do we need to know them today? Friends, if you have hit a dead end, well, the Lord who was there at the beginning can be the Lord of the fresh start for us today. And the Lord of life longs to bring his dynamic life to bubble up within us and be at work through us. Is there an area where we need that life today? And the Lord of illumination and brilliant light longs to bring that light to bear in the hidden places of our life, in the hidden places of our world. Do we want it? Well, how do we get it? Well, later on in this chapter, John tells us in verse 12, he says this: yet to those who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. That's one of my favourite verses, because that's all it takes: a heart to receive him and believing in his name. And as we'll sing in just a few days' time, I'm sure, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in. The Logos, the origin, the source, with his life and his light. So as we head towards Advent and come to Christmas, I pray, may you see the living God in Christ Jesus as John sees him, and may you know his light, his life, and love at work in your life as never before.
Hello everyone. It's lovely to have this opportunity to share something with you of my journey over these last few months. At best, these months have been challenging, and at worst, for some, they've been cruel. But knowing Jesus, we can all face these days believing that he is in control, and we can trust that he will somehow fulfill his purposes through all of this, even if we can't see it now. Very briefly, I'd like to share with you three surprises, three lessons, and three requests. So, three surprises. I first stepped out into Christian ministry in 1989, so about 32 years ago, but for the past 18 of those years, I've served with Christian Vocations and Global Connections. The first surprise came in March this year, as it did for everyone when everything changed as the pandemic first hit. But I continued to work for a few months to rethink and then reinvent our organisation with our small team. The second surprise came at the end of May when I was furloughed. And at the start, it felt like an enforced sabbatical, so I treated it as such and I welcomed the change of pace. Then came surprise number three. The news I dreaded came at the end of June when I was made redundant. And the language used in a redundancy process emphasises that it's the role that's being made redundant and not the person. But when you're the one that's going through it, it's impossible to separate those two things. So after 18 years of service with Christian Vocations and Global Connections, there's been a lot to process emotionally, spiritually and professionally. I look back on many years of great fulfillment, being able to use my gifts and gain experience across a wide range of ministries. But what would I do now? So there were three lessons that I've been learning and I'm still learning. You know, in these difficult days, many are talking about our freedoms being taken away from us. But there's one freedom that can't be taken away from us, and that's the attitude with which we choose to respond to our circumstances. So my three lessons are also possibly relevant for you too. The first thing is to regain an attitude of gratitude. There's always something to be thankful for. And I've learned a lot from an experience that whilst it's been painful and might have engendered bitterness, the Lord's presence has been so real and his purposes have begun to unfold in his time. The second lesson, to realise my identity is in who I am as a child of God and not in what I do. My confidence took a huge knock and my recovery has been slow, but I know that the Lord who began a good work in me will carry it on to completion. Third lesson, recognise when God is at work. Catherine Booth's words have been very poignant for me. And she said this, to better the future, we must disturb the present. I realised that this was God's way of moving me on to something new. After much prayer and seeking the Lord, my husband Mark and I have both had a sense that we need to take a new step of faith, which is to take everything that the Lord has invested in me over these years and start a new venture called Serve 7. And that is to offer support to mission organisations free of charge in 7 key ministry areas. It sounds completely bonkers, I realise that, but we both believe that this is what the Lord is asking of us at this time. So I have 3 requests, if I may, and they are for your prayers. Pray for this planning stage and getting set up to hopefully launch in the new year. To pray that the Lord would open up new opportunities to serve his mission in new ways. And I'm already in discussion with 2 organisations about future work. Thirdly, pray for God's provision for the needed finance to make this happen. Our dependence is on the Lord for what this step of faith is going to hold for both me and Mark. We're so grateful for the support of St John's and I'm privileged to remain as a GPS partner. If you'd like to find out more or partner with us individually as we take this new step, you can find my details on my church suite, or you may already have my details, or you could contact the church office. Thank you so much.
We begin our prayers by taking a few moments of quiet to reflect on some verses from the beginning of John's Gospel that remind us who Jesus really was and is today and will be for all eternity. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. The Word became flesh and lived for a while among us. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. May our hearts be filled with thanksgiving to God for sending Jesus. And now we say together, thank you, Heavenly Father, for Jesus, our beginning, our life, and our light. May we draw comfort and strength from knowing him and receiving the life he offers us. And may his light banish the darkness in our hearts and send us out to be light bearers in our needy world. Amen. We rejoice this week that the vaccination against COVID-19 has begun to be rolled out, giving us all hope for next year. But we know that many are struggling at this time, and today we pray for all the opportunities we have to bless those around us, whether it's giving our time, donating food items, clothing and food vouchers, or giving money to enable others to meet the needs of those struggling in our country and in other countries around the world. And so we pray. Lord, you have blessed us with so much. Help us to give gladly at this time, that we might be a channel of your blessing to others. Strengthen the arm of all those working with the homeless, in women's refuges, with needy families, with refugees. Protect each one from the virus and multiply their resources, we pray. Amen. We heard earlier from Jo Jowett about her new calling from God to offer specialist services to mission organisations, and we're going to pray for her now. Heavenly Father, thank you for the way Jo and Mark have known your comfort, provision and guidance as Jo experienced the loss of her job and waited on you for a new direction. Thank you for the step of faith she and Mark are taking as Serve 7 is launched. Would you guide clearly in these initial stages that new opportunities will come for Jo to bless and support mission organisations in their endeavours to make Jesus known in every part of the world? We pray too for new partners who will want to pray and support Serve 7 financially. May we as a church continue to pray and stand alongside Jo in this new calling. We pray too for others in our fellowship who have experienced the loss of their jobs at this time. May they also experience your provision of finances in the immediate and of employment in the future. May we as their sisters and brothers stand alongside to support practically and strengthen their hearts. Hear us, Lord, we pray. We finish our prayers with this Sabbath Advent prayer of blessing for ourselves and for each other. May this day bring Sabbath rest to our hearts and our homes. May our peace and perspective be renewed in the busyness of this season. May our hands be free enough from spending and acquiring to receive your gift. May a little of the wonder and magic of Christmas awaken the child within us today. And may God's word feed us and his Spirit lead us into the week and into the life to come. Amen.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today as we have sought the presence of the Lord in the midst of our worship together. Next Sunday, we have the first of our Christmas services. It's our carol service, and we're going to be broadcasting that at 6 p.m. Please do be thinking about who you might be able to invite to that service. And you can find more details about it at stjohnsharbourne.org/Christmas. And in January, we're going to be following up with a new Alpha course that's going to be online, looking at the claims of Jesus. Please, again, do be thinking and praying who you might invite to that. And if you're here and considering the claims of the Christian faith for yourself, please do think about signing up for that. That's at stjohnsharbourne.org/alpha. And just to say, the final deadline for getting our Christmas videos in for our Christmas Day service is the 16th of December. So as we close, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you that Jesus is our beginning, our life, and our light. Please so work in the hearts of each one of us that we may daily discover more of our purpose, our motivation, and our guidance in and through him. We ask it in his precious name. Amen.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore he in Christ the Lord. God of God, light of light eternal, though he abhors not the virgin's womb. Son of the Father, begotten, not created, oh come let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore he in Christ the Lord. Sing choirs of angels, sing in exultation, sing for